Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Great. Micheline, thank you for the generous introduction. As Micheline said, our focus this year is empowerment. Last year was our first Cloud Summit, and we had a theme of trailblazers, thought leaders, people who are really progressive, who are pioneers, because the customers who are here, you are pioneers. You actually embrace cloud. You embrace transformation long before many other companies did. And in empowerment today, we'll have two main things. One, if you got good solutions that can help you do transformation, that's where empowerment comes from. And two, empowerment comes from learning, knowing, exchanging stories. Hopefully, over the next 2 days, there'll be plenty of opportunities for all of you to exchange thoughts and ideas and learn from all of us, because we all learn from each other. So let's start with the digital transformation theme I talked about. This is becoming a buzzword. Just like anything, once it becomes popular, every company co-opts it. But overall, digital transformation is a business imperative. It's actually needed to succeed. It's really all about making sure our business is becoming more agile, our business is becoming more competitive. And those things come from being able to really have better applications, better access to applications by your employees, by your customers, by your partners. And cloud simply is giving you the flexibility to spin up the compute, to spin up the storage, to spin up new applications quickly. Mobility allows you to work from anywhere, anytime. And mobile devices give you a lot more information that you couldn't collect otherwise. And internet is becoming the corporate network, whereby anybody from anywhere can really access whatever application and services you need. And AI and machine learning is able to decipher and figure out some of the hidden trends and information you couldn't see before. So all these things together are making businesses more competitive. And businesses who really don't adapt and embrace it will be left behind. Now, the diagram I'm sharing with you really talks about how the traffic pattern will change. Your workforce, which is your employees, your partners, could be sitting anywhere. They need access to certain information. B2B, your customers and suppliers, need to engage with you far more frequently than they did before. And these, what we call things, which is IoT and OT together, there is a lot of interaction. You need to access and manage some of those industrial control systems. And IoTs are becoming a very important part of all the controls to collect information, whether the health of a device or whatever the information may be. So fundamentally, as Gartner said, this transformation is changing the network patterns. It's changing how you access information. In this kind of world, where would you put your traditional security boxes? Where will you deploy a firewall? When I start Zscaler, thinking about a world of cloud and mobility, our mission and focus became to provide fast, secure, and reliable access to information no matter where it lives. And that's really what we're focused on, to help you get that information easily. 11 years later, the dream we started out has become a reality. We're very proud of the fact that over 400 of the largest global 2,000 companies have become our customers. And it's not just that these logos up there. All traffic that's headed to the internet or SaaS, all of that traffic actually goes through Zscaler. You know, when I started the company, I thought I'll start selling to mid-sized companies, because the large companies will say, who is this startup? Why should I do business with them? And then soon, we saw an RFE coming from GE, General Electric, say, I want proxy gateway in the cloud. You know, guess what? We competed for that business. We won a technical evaluation. But then the finance called and said, we'd like to do your financial viability. Please send us your 3 years financial statements. The deal stopped there. Then we came across Nestle very early on, who was looking for solving the problem of only having four internet gateways for 160,000 employees and lots of user complaints. They were so impressed with the solution that they sent an RFP around, which was very progressive RFP. Thanks to Frederick and team, who actually thought of it 2011, about 8 years ago, and Nestle became one of our early customers. Coming back to the GE story, so GE actually bought a solution from a large traditional company that was kind of a cloud solution because it was a single tenant proxy hosted and sitting in the cloud. So GE called 18 months later and said, we need to see you next week. We knew something had gone wrong. And a month of discussions and dialogue, GE became a Zscaler customer in 2012. And now we have some 400,000 employees who go through us. So it is because of success with some of those large companies, we actually focus on larger companies. And that became helpful for us. So all of you guys are early adopters. You made us successful. In fact, some of these large companies are very demanding. We like that because it helps us to really keep on improving our solutions. And my special thanks to our EMEA customers, our European customers. But 50% of Zscaler revenue comes from outside the US, which is very unusual for a young company of our stage. And out of that, out of the international sales, about 80 to 85% come out of Europe. So thank you for your business. To scale this company, as we got lots of these customers, we needed an architecture that scales, that could handle traffic. I got the lesson very early on, one of my prior customers. This is a consumer goods company in the US. I knew the CISO well. As I was building PowerPoints about what I'm going to build, I took it to this customer to share with him to see if he would like to buy this solution. I asked him, how many gateway boxes do you have? He said, lots. I said, how many? He said, lots. He didn't really know the number. Okay. Finally, he guessed. He said, probably over 100 boxes, sitting about 20 in my data centers. Then there are about 15 gateways I know of, and many I don't know of. So I came back and said, wow, if each large company could have scores of boxes just to be the internet gateway, if I need to build a cloud business, and I need to really put the same kind of boxes in each data center, I'll never make money. We need to build something that's meant for scale, for cloud scale. So it came back, we named the company Zscaler, which stands for Zenith of Scalability. The goal was we focus on building technology that scales, and the byproduct of that became amazing throughput and response time for end users. So we want to build something at a line speed so inspection could happen, and we chose proxy technology because it could actually do full inspection, unlike pass-through firewalls, which really give you speed but no security. So I thank all Zscaler employees, our partners, to really working with us to give us the opportunity to build this kind of service to serve your needs. In this cloud, the numbers become amazing. When we got to 1 billion transactions a day, we had a big party in the office because it is a big thing. Now sitting at 70 to 75 billion transactions a day, every day a few billion here and there, it doesn't even matter because the scale has become so massive. I mean, last 12 months, about 718 petabytes processed. To put in perspective, If you scan every web page on the internet about 70 times, that's how much traffic we processed for security and policy enforcement in the past year. And the reason these numbers are so big is because when, say, Siemens, traffic goes to the internet, whether it goes to Salesforce or Google or Facebook or Office 365, it all goes through Zscaler for policy enforcement. If you compare a couple of other data points, Google does about 8 billion, actually 7 billion transactions a day for Google search only. Salesforce, about 8 billion transactions. Our volume is high because we handle everything, but then we must have scale to be able to handle it very well. This gives you a perspective of the kind of traffic that goes through the internet. Look at Office 365. About 3 years ago, it used to be less than 5%, about 4% of the total traffic through the cloud of Zscaler was Office. Look at where YouTube was, about 16 to 17%. Office has gone to about 25% now. 25% of the total traffic that goes through Zscaler Cloud is Office 365. Look at the line at the bottom. It's Salesforce, number one application in enterprises. It was about 1%, and today it's about 1%. This doesn't mean Salesforce hasn't grown. Zscaler Cloud is growing about 70 to 80% year over year. So for Salesforce to keep 1% share, it has to grow at that pace. It just tells that how much traffic Office 365 has picked up. Now, you're seeing YouTube coming down. Now, it's not that people are watching less YouTube. Now, in the enterprise space, when customers start to do local breakout, they found that YouTube starts competing with Office 365 and other applications. So we actually built a service called Bandwidth Quality of Service, where you can control and prioritize business applications over streaming. And that's one of the key factors why this is happening. Microsoft, under Satya Nadella, has become a very partner-friendly company. Okay. We have done a lot of work with them. There's a fair amount of synergy between the two companies because their goal is to make sure applications like Office 365 get deployed fast and have user experience. And good experience actually depends upon many things, but number one thing for user experience is local internet breakout so you don't backhaul traffic. And hence you look at Satya's focus on working together for user experience. That's a wonderful thing. His focus and our focus are very well aligned. Zscaler wasn't built just to do user traffic. In fact, our goal was, as we sit as a check post between your enterprise and the internet, we should be able to see every traffic that leaves your company, almost like international airport. You want to see everything that goes in and out. Look at 1 billion transactions per month we're seeing from IoT devices. A copier, a printer, a security camera is calling out there. And many times, they're totally unprotected. Our CISO has done many demos where you can actually get hold of a copier or a printer remotely and really control them, print them, or do whatever kind of stuff can be done. Whether it's smart TVs or smart watches, all this kind of stuff will play a bigger and bigger role. And we actually act as a gateway for you to understand the first thing, what is leaving, where are these devices calling, where should they be calling. And we're building more and more reporting around this type of information. Server traffic used to be very little. Now the amount of traffic that's leaving your servers from your data center to AWS or even getting some information such as currency exchange information, that information is growing more and more. And we want to make sure you understand the information and you can put policies around it. To scale the cloud, and to deliver a reliable service is not a trivial thing. One of the things I learned from this company was building a product that sits in line to handle traffic, inspect it, without introducing latency is very hard. But having a cloud that works all the time is harder. Building a product and shipping to the customer and say it's customer's problem, is much easier than making a cloud sure that cloud is working all the time. So we're very, very focused on cloud. We have a very strong team of engineers and cloud infrastructure team that's focused on scaling and making sure everything works reliably. So we are in the fourth generation of our data center design. When I started, I never knew we'll have to essentially be almost like an ISP where we had to control traffic coming the BGP routes. If a packet loss is happening somewhere, we need to reroute traffic. But all those things are part of the design of a data center service we need to give you. And the local breakouts are playing a very, very important role in this area. And that's why we got some 150 data centers where Zscaler service sitting. So your traffic can go to the nearest data center. Enforcement happens, and you go where you need to go. This is very different than having an on-ramp. We've been seeing some misinformation being spread by some of the legacy vendors who are trying to spin their firewalls in the VMs in AWS or Google Cloud and say we got 100-some data centers. There's a difference in on-ramps and actual data center where processing happens. When you purpose-built a cloud, you do it right. When you try to retrofit it, you don't. And having the experience to run a massive cloud like this takes lots of experience. As someone said, there's no algorithm for experience. You have to learn it, and that's what my team has done. And then doing a bunch of certifications that enterprises require, whether it's a FedRAMP for federal government, or SOC, or ISO 20007-1. And last, the most important one, 27018, which is about international cloud PII privacy. Making sure we take all the steps that are needed for privacy. So these certifications are important to ensure data privacy, ensuring better security, and these certifications also ensure that we can deliver better availability because of better processes, better controls, and the like. And some of the things we did very early on with the right design is helping us. When we were building the service, we were thinking about data privacy, and just thinking about caching of content to deliver you faster information. We chose not to do content caching to give you better data privacy. Now, early on, we lost a few deals because customers were looking for data caching. But we knew that in the long run, caching in today's dynamic world will be less important. Privacy will be more important. So the call we made at that time actually has served us pretty well. The other thing I'm very proud of is the number of customer support tickets we get every day. So this graph shows how many tickets we get for every billion transactions in our cloud. The number has been steadily coming down from about 6, 7, now sitting at about 3. About 3 customer tickets for every billion transactions. If the cloud runs well, if the product is high quality, the fewer bugs, that means fewer the tickets. And this is because of our demanding customers. This is because of great engineers that we have done this. And we'll stay our focus on this to make sure it keeps on getting better and better. So let me switch towards some of the architectural and platform innovations were done to serve you, because if the architecture is not right, nothing else matters. All of you are familiar with hub and spoke network. In fact, you run and you manage the network all the time. This network made sense when data center was the center of the universe. Your private network was built and optimized to go to the data center with the lowest latency. Then cloud has come. The patterns are changing. More and more information is going to the cloud, whether it's going to internet or SaaS applications or a public cloud. That's changing traffic patterns. The security is still sitting in the data center. Hence, the internet traffic is being backhauled. I recall a discussion I had with Larry Bagini, who was the global CISO of GE at that time. He said, my sales force never comes to the office, nor they should, because they are with their customers and partners. But I forced them to come in so they could go out. Because that's how things are set up. Security is in the data center, they come and go out. He started to create three problems. One, poor response time. Two, we pay for the bandwidth for them to come back. Three, I bring them in on my network before they leave, so I'm actually creating security issues by putting people on my network who shouldn't be on my network. So the notion really is pretty simple. The traffic should go direct, but it doesn't because the castle and moat security we built is very expensive. I look at this castle, and the moat is built by these security appliances. It used to be a simple firewall. Then as more and more threats came around, people had to add more and more stuff. So I call it a drawbridge to go out of the castle. Then there's a drawbridge to come in the castle, because that's a different kind of security that gets done. Even for large companies, these drawbridges are expensive. These moats are very expensive. That's why trying to take it and put it in various branch offices is not a practical thing. Now, the companies are trying to say, can I take my firewalls and put it in Azure or AWS or GCP and really build a castle there? Extend your network over to a public cloud further. All right. Obviously, it's very hard. It makes little sense. But everyone is trying to do it because the network architecture has to change. A typical Fortune 500 company spend somewhere between $20 million to $200 million on their private network. And at least half of the traffic on the network is internet bound. If you peel off half the traffic, your user experience goes up, your network cost goes down. Something like that has to be done because the number of gateways is growing. In fact, I was talking to a CISO about a year ago. I asked him, how many employees do you have? He said, 10,000. He said, how many internet gateways do you have? He said, 10,000. Well, he said, every employee is a laptop, and the laptop goes where the employee goes. It's a gateway to the internet. Then he paused and said, sorry, I misspoke. Every employee has a laptop, but every employee has a mobile phone and a tablet, too. I have 25,000 internet gateways. That's the way to think about it. So it's not a matter of taking my four gateways, changing to 8 or 12. In fact, the things get even worse. As 5G happens, whether it's next year or 2 years later, when you get amazing speed and you're sitting in your office, you won't connect to your local area network. You'll go direct. If you're building something today for transformation, think about building for the world, where anyone should be able to go out anywhere. All of your IoT devices aren't going to come back to a gateway to go out. They needed to be able to get out. So trying to build this kind of stuff using the old school technology will be like trying to build a Netflix service using traditional DVD players by putting them in a data center. It just doesn't work. So Gartner has actually come with two very good white papers. They are a must read for anyone doing transformation. One is the future of network security is in the cloud. And the second is zero trust network access. How do you really provide access to applications without putting people on the network? And these two papers are available from Gartner directly if you have a service, or they're also available from our website. But three things there: compute at the edge, near where the user is, and branch should be light with the SD-WAN device or a router going directly to the cloud, and inspection of traffic for security, as SSL is an important thing to protect your information, but SSL is abused by bad guys as well. So the way Zscaler has looked at the solution is not really in a typical way to build a gateway in the cloud. In fact, we felt like if you're going over the internet, how do you secure the internet? You don't. So why do network security? Let's not worry about doing network security. Let's think about being a policy engine that sits between the user and the application. So the user connects to us, and based on the business policy, we connect the right user to right applications. User is a starting point. This could be things, it could be devices, it could be machine to machine. So if you use that approach, it doesn't matter what the device is, it doesn't matter if the application is external or internal, and you use business policies, not talking about IP addresses. And the most important thing, by putting people on, not on the network, simply connecting them to the right application, the notion of inside my firewall, outside my firewall should disappear. Because when your application is sitting in Azure, is that inside or is that outside? There isn't any inside or outside, and that's how your solution should be built. So the way we built this thing, we're looking at applications as destinations. You're sitting somewhere in the branch office, a data center or headquarters, and we focus on three areas. You got workforce, you got things, and you got customers. So we started out with building a platform, a multi-tenant platform. The inspiration for that came from Salesforce. We built a policy engine, we built a high-speed SSL decryption capabilities. We have been leveraging machine learning to analyze all the logs. We've been doing full logging, full API-based capabilities. And then on top of this platform, we built applications and services that you use. But most important for that was to be able to really build this distributed platform where our service could be sitting in any of those 150 locations we talked about to minimize your response time. And at the request of the customers, now we have extended the service as a private service edge to your own data centers in certain cases when you want this thing to be on-prem. So giving you the flexibility of choosing our global or public data centers and having a private version of it. And sitting on top of the platform we built, Zscaler Internet Access, most of you are probably using ZIS, Zscaler Internet Access, that allows inspection of traffic coming from your workforce or things such as IoT devices calling the internet or any of those destinations. And the second service, Zscaler Private Access, to allow you access to your private application sitting in your data center or sitting in Azure or AWS and the like. So really, think of all applications falling in two buckets. External applications that you don't manage, those are SaaS and internet. For that, ZIA is inspecting and enforcing policy. For internal applications, you're using ZPA to make sure the right person has access to the right application without you having to worry about is it internal, is it external. That's a very, very important point from user experience point of view. So really what we are doing, the ZIA, if I drill down a little bit, is your workforce being able to access SaaS or internet. And the way we built it as a platform, we did not go out and buy five companies and try to put them in five VMs and put a little front end to it and say, this is Zscaler Internet Service. We built it from scratch as a common platform. If you do it right, it's not overly complicated because we take traffic once, we authenticate the user once, we decrypt SSL once, and we make it available for as a firewall policy or web filtering or DLP and the like. But it's a fully integrated service. That's why once you buy Zscaler, adding on Cloud Sandbox is simply a one click. Adding on a firewall service to handle all protocols is fairly simple as well. You know, we tried to OEM third-party services early on. I thought my development team was being a little too what we call NIH, not invented here. So we OEM'd a DLP module to try to integrate it And this was from a company called 1-2 Semantic. Then we found that the line speed traffic you're inspecting crawled to about 50 megabits per second because the DLP engine just wasn't meant to scale. That's when our chief architect said, Jay, you wanted me to build a jet engine, and you want me to use the parts meant for propeller planes. I said, look, no worries, go and build the rest of the stuff yourself. Okay. So we have been building a lot of these services in line so things don't slow down. In the last year, we added a couple of very exciting services. Exec Data Match takes DLP to the next level, where we can actually do match against your customer database. You've got 20 million users. You want to make sure that personal information doesn't leak out. We can do exact match for that. And enhance our IPS service around. So with that, I want to bring a customer here to share the customer story or deployment of Zscaler internet access. This company rolled out some 56,000 users with cloud firewall, with sandbox, with full SSL inspection, because 90% of their traffic is SSL encrypted. Office 365 is big part of the traffic, about 40% of the traffic. In a typical enterprise, when you roll out Office 365, it's somewhere in the 35 to 50% based on what function you use. So you got to be ready for that. So without further ado, I'd like to invite Ulrika Goos, who is the Managing Director of Digital Technology at Eon, to share her experience with us. Hello.
Good morning.
Morning, morning.
Good morning, everybody.
Move down here.
Morning.
Morning, morning. So, I thought Eon was a pretty large company until I read the news last week.
Yes, we were a large company already with 45,000 employees. And just 2 weeks ago, we got the confirmation from the European Union that we are allowed to merge with Innogy. So meanwhile, we have more than 80,000 employees in our companies. We almost doubled.
Wow. So, wow, some more fun work to integrate the two companies together.
Absolutely. Thank you very much.
Now, you have already been on this transformation journey to the cloud. What were some of the business drivers to do so?
Absolutely. It was mainly the speed to market. You know, we really need to go into the digital age, and we started a couple of years ago to really drive that new green revolution, which meant for us in IT to also go into the cloud and go into the cloud fast.
Cloud is green.
Cloud is green, absolutely.
Buy fewer boxes to buy and handle.
Absolutely.
That's pretty good. Now, lots of companies, when they start, Office 365 becomes an important application for collaboration and many things. I understand you were rolling out Office 365. Was the infrastructure ready?
To be honest, not. It was not. So we were rolling out Office 365, and I'm sure many of you have done very similar things. And we got the money for the rollout for the Office 365. We knew we would have to do something on the network, but we didn't get the budget approval. However, as you can imagine, we got into huge trouble. And just to bring one specific example, when I got a call from the CEO who called me in my, I have to say I'm with Eon now for 1 year, and this was 1 month after I've started. Wow. You get a call from your CEO, and he tells you that people are complaining because they have to wait for their files to open for more than 10 minutes.
10 minutes, right.
And this was, of course, a disaster. As you can
budget
imagine.
Opened up.
Pardon?
Budget opened up.
Budget opened up, you can guess. And it opened up very, very quickly. Of course, in the beginning, we did, like many companies, we tried to solve the problem with task forces all over the place. And I came in and I said, look, this problem, we cannot solve it with task forces. Of course, it will help us in the short term to get some stability into the network, but there's more to be done. Mm-hmm. And yeah, then when we started a huge, what we call main, modernize and improve network project. Mm-hmm. And I was really glad when Stan Lowe.
Yeah, our CISO.
Yes. When he came to visit me last year in November, and I was in the midst of this turmoil and trouble, and he came and showed me on the flip chart your architecture and your solution for our problem.
Yeah?
Absolutely. Yeah. So I was really glad, and I, at that time, when he showed me this architecture, for me it was the light at the end of the tunnel.
Right, that's what took you to, right. I think it's such a logical solution. You know, this is not uncommon. I'll share with you about 2.5 years ago, a big medical equipment company in US, they rolled out Office 365. CIO made the decision, rolled it out without talking to the networking team. Guess what happened? You all know what happened, right? And the networking teams goes and try to solve it, trying to really do the traditional way. Then they called Gartner and said, Gartner said, talk to Zscaler. And they said, no, Gartner, you don't understand. I have a networking problem. We know Zscaler, it's a security company. Okay. Gartner said, no, go and talk to them. So the main thing was changing your hub and spoke to local breakout and where security is needed. So, good. How has the rollout gone for you?
Up to now, the rollout is going pretty good. In the first place, of course, we are doing the local internet breakouts and in as many places as possible to make sure that the users have the benefit of the internet.
Right.
And this has somehow stabilized our situation. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But we're not where we want to be yet.
You're still doing more breakouts.
Absolutely.
SD-WAN is part of the project. Yeah. You're rolling out.
We have this main project that I was talking about is running until end of next year. Mm-hmm. And by the end of next year, we will want to have a full-fledged software-defined network using also your ZPA.
ZPA, right. Internal application access.
Absolutely.
That's wonderful. Rulika, thank you. Appreciate your support. We'll keep on making sure everything is fully supported when you bring the two companies together without having to bring the networks together.
Thank you, Jay. Thanks great. For having great. Me.
Great. Bye-bye. Appreciate it. You'll hear more about Zscaler Private Access later, how you can integrate the two companies without having to integrate the two networks. Now, so moving on, I talked about some of the new functionality we added in the past. We got a very innovative and driven engineering team that keeps on bringing functionality at a very high speed. So in the recent past, we have added three main things. CASB, we have been doing in-band, but added out-of-band, browser isolation, and a lot more about machine learning. Now, I would like to invite Amit Sinha, our president R&D and CTO on stage, to really showcase some of the new innovations our engineering has done. Yeah.
Good morning, Jay.
Thank you.
Great. Well, that was great. Good morning.
Thank you.
All right, so machine learning and AI. It seems like you cannot go anywhere these days without hearing about machine learning and AI. I was at a bar recently, and the bartender pitched me a machine learning-powered poker startup idea. So, you know, anywhere you go in the Bay Area these days, people are talking about machine learning and AI. But as I tell everyone and I tell my team, there are three very important pillars that define any good machine learning solution. The first is data. Data is the new currency. If you don't have data, there isn't much data analysis and machine learning that you could do. The second is data scientists and data engineers who can build the models, who can glean the information out from the data that you have. And the third often overlooked area is your domain expertise. You know, if you want to build a machine learning model for radiology, you have to have radiologists. If you want to build a machine learning model for security, you need to have domain experts who understand what is good and what is bad. So at Zscaler, we have a unique combination of all of those three, and I'm going to show you a glimpse of how we are using that to solve some real problems. So let's talk about data. I thought it might be useful, instead of me showing you a PowerPoint, to ask Alexa, what's the size of data Zscaler is dealing with today? So let's give this a shot.
Zscaler processed 70 billion transactions in the last 24 hours and blocked 84 million threats worldwide. Zscaler Cloud Sandbox received 234,000 files for behavioral analysis, of which 99.2% were benign. Zscaler's machine learning-based threat detection was able to deliver a verdict on files with an average analysis time of 12 milliseconds. Overall, 227 new malicious files were detected and confirmed in the sandbox. Would you like more details?
No, thank you, Alexa. So hopefully you got some of the gist. So on a daily basis, Zscaler is seeing about 70 to 80 billion transactions, and we block about 100 million of those as threats. And you get the true cloud effect. If we see a piece of malware on GE's network, Siemens is protected. If we see malware on Hyatt's network, United Airlines is protected. However, at the end of all of that analysis, we still end up on a daily basis with about 200 to 300,000 new files that nobody seems to know anything about. And as you heard, out of those 200, 300,000 files, less than 1% are actually malicious. So we end up making users wait in our cloud sandbox for the 99% of the files that generally turn out to be benign. And you heard Eon, nobody likes to wait 10 minutes to get that file that they're really after. So let me take you through a use case. How many of you here use a cloud sandbox? Good. You know, generally, you always have to choose between user experience and security. In the world of IT, IT generally is regarded as a department of no, and security is not really something that is synonymous with user experience. And that's something we often see. People have to trade off security policies for user experience. So let me show you what that looks like in Cloud Sandbox. In Cloud Sandbox, you generally have a policy where if you see a piece of malware for the first time, you have a choice. Should I let that through, or should I quarantine it? And usually, the sandbox takes about 10 minutes to do a behavioral analysis scan and deliver a verdict. So in that 10 minutes, the user can get frustrated. So let me take you through a classic use case that happens very frequently. Here's an applicant who has applied through the portal and sent in his resume. This is Steve Gates, and he's applied for a big data position, included a resume, which is a Dropbox link, and as soon as the recruiter clicks on that link, she gets this page, right? This is a resume with probably some embedded macro in it, and what does that lead to? That leads to a frustrated user, right? So this is a classic example of user experience suffering because you wanted to have high security. Now, you look at it, and then typically this leads to one of two scenarios. If the users are very strong in the organization, they'll yell at IT and say, hey, I hate this quarantine feature. You need to go ahead and remove this quarantine. I want to download my files ASAP, and I'm willing to take the risk. And depending on how strict the IT security controls are, it might lead to a scenario where now you have a policy that allows malware that is sent to the sandbox for scanning to get downloaded while it's being scanned. And what does that lead to? That generally leads to, you know, some sort of a ransomware outbreak because you're taking that risk. You are allowing zero-day threats to be downloaded onto users' machines while the scanning is happening. So we said, look, there's got to be a better way, right? We are seeing all of these files. We, you know, in a perfect world, with the 300,000 new files that you're seeing, with machine learning, you should be able to predict whether a file is good or bad with the same level of accuracy as the sandbox. So that's precisely what we did. So now, in the near future, you're going to see in our sandbox the ability to quickly allow popular documents, like Word documents, PDFs. These are files that are being generated quite frequently. Those can be quickly scanned within a few milliseconds and delivered to the user with very, very low exposure. And a copy of that is sent to the sandbox for further analysis. So what is the net result? Well, the net result is instead of getting a blog page, you know, in that recruiter scenario, she actually gets the resume and, you know, what do you have? A happy user. Isn't that refreshing? Security not getting in your way, but you're not compromising the security effectiveness. Now, many of the security experts will say, well, I want explainable AI. I don't want a black box telling me this file is bad. I want to understand why. So as I mentioned, a copy of the file is sent to the sandbox. Sandbox is still a very good defense, and we'll scan it. And in the sandbox reports, you'll start seeing machine learning scores. So here you'd see, hey, machine learning told me with a high confidence that this file was bad, and here's a full detailed sandbox report that is telling you indeed it was bad based on true behavioral analysis captured in the sandbox. Make sense? All right. So what does machine learning do for security? Well, better security, better user experience. You don't need to trade that off. You know, you can integrate it with the sandbox, and it's in a continuous learning environment where new samples are coming in, and it gets better and better every day. There are a bunch of other use cases that we are leveraging for machine learning. As I mentioned, we're just scratching the tip of the iceberg here. Better malware is one of them, but we're also looking at using machine learning to classify content, whether it is URL classification or DLP-based content classification. We're also looking at being able to capture user anomalies. You know, maybe there is an exfiltration attempt happening. All of those are anomalies that machine learning algorithms are very good at capturing. And finally, we're also looking at improving user experience, and we'll talk a bit about that in the latter half of the session. So switching gears, let's talk a bit about CASB. How many of you use Zscaler's current inline CASB features? Very few hands. I'm hoping some of those things will change. So Zscaler has always been an inline proxy. The hardest thing is being inline, being able to do SSL inspection, being able to do content classification. And as an inline proxy, we give you all the shadow IT reports, all the malware protection that you'd expect, DLP, making sure nothing good is leaking out, and policy-based user controls. You can say, hey, engineering department is allowed read-only access to Facebook. Everyone else is allowed, you know, full access. So those are the types of controls that we've been doing since day one because we've done the hard part of being an inline proxy. Some of our customers have said, well, you've already solved the problem 80, 90% of the way. Can you use APIs and instead of just scanning data in motion, can you enforce CASB controls using APIs? So I have a bunch of sanctioned apps on OneDrive or Box, and what I'd like to do is I'd like the Zscaler Cloud to access that content via APIs and run the same malware and DLP engines and be able to give me the CASB controls that I want. So I'm happy to announce that that's exactly what we've done, and let me show you a quick preview of what will show up in the Zscaler Cloud very shortly. So two scenarios. Let's say scenario one, I hear this all the time. The board wants to know, is our private data exposed, right? We've started using, let's say, a Box or OneDrive or SharePoint, and there's concern that there might be PII information, there might be link sharing enabled, et cetera. So what do? You go to the Zscaler admin console, and all you have to do is authorize the cloud to access your tenant. So in this case, here's an example for Box. You choose Box as the application provider. You provide the application ID, and that's pretty much it. You're off to the races. It's just an API key that allows Zscaler to go to your tenant and start scanning for those files. And you can do the same thing for OneDrive, for SharePoint, et cetera. Now, once you've authorized Zscaler to scan your Box tenant, you want to set up some policies. So here, let me take you through an example of a DLP policy. Maybe you want to check if HR documents in Box have the right permissions for PII. So what do? You add a DLP rule, very similar to the criteria action that you're used to in the current Zscaler console. So in this case, it'll be a PII discovery rule, and I'm going to choose Box as my tenant. I'll use HR as the department. I'll look for personal identifiers in Word documents, and I'm going to check for documents that have an external collaboration scope enabled. And in this case, I just want to report the incident. I don't want to take any corrective action. And once you've done that, that's it. You have a DLP rule that will scan at-rest files in Box. Similarly, you can do the same policy for malware. Maybe a contractor has shared something via Box or OneDrive, and you want to check if there's malware in it. You'd go to the malware policy, and just like DLP, you'd add a simple malware policy. You choose the application, you choose the tenant, and then you're off to the races. So you have a malware policy, and you have a DLP policy that's now going to scan at-rest documents and run the same exact engines that we've done when that was crossing the Zscaler network boundary. Make sense? Once you do that, what do you get? Pretty straightforward. You get a CASB report. It scans your tenants. In this case, it scanned 9,000 files, found 547 incidents. It shows you those incidents across Box, OneDrive, and SharePoint. There were 472 DLP incidents, 75 malware incidents. You can look at trends over time. We are maintaining how your scanning and corrective actions are improving your DLP and malware posture. It gives you how your data is distributed across your sanctioned apps. So you can see there's a bunch of data in Box, OneDrive, and SharePoint in this case. And then you can see all kinds of reporting and analytics that we have traditionally provided you for DLP and malware, except now this is available for at-rest files in your sanctioned apps. You can see departments with the most incidents, users with the most incidents. We also include risky cloud applications in this report. We've always had that in our standard CASB policies, but you can see it in this report as well. Now, once you've done that, you did a PII scan to discover what was exposed. Maybe you want to take some corrective action. So here, you go back to the rule, and if you recall, we had set the rule to just report the incident but not take any corrective actions. Now, with API-based controls, in the past, as a proxy, we could allow, block, or caution, but now we can go ahead and, in this case, change the permissions and revoke the sharing permissions on those specific files that were discovered as part of the CASB scan. Make sense? Right? So a lot of granular actions can be generated once you have API-based controls as opposed to just simple allow block and caution type rules. So once you've done that, those permissions are corrected, and it's continuously scanning in the background. So net-net, what does this do? Well, we've always been an inline CASB engine, and now you have the ability to have those same consistent security and DLP policies, both inline and out of band, right? It's based on APIs, it gives you that full security stack, and it includes both discovery and remediation. And we'll keep adding new and newer apps to it as we go along. Make sense? All right, so with that, I'd like to hand it back to Jay, and more to come, so stay tuned. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Amit. So you see these new innovations are fully integrated. In fact, in the case of Sandbox, machine learning, you don't even need to do anything. Behind the scene, we're making this technology work smarter and smarter to deliver you better experience for you.